Hi, welcome to this new episode of Understanding Gradle. In the previous videos, we have looked at Java modularity and in particular at the class pass concept, which is the foundation of modularizing Java applications. We have learned that in a multi-module project, you have to deal with multiple class passes, which allow you to isolate components. We have seen how you can optimize these class passes by doing analysis on them and making Gradle detect possible collisions. The tools or Gradle plugins we have looked at so far were mostly concerned with analyzing the compile class passes. One thing that more concerns the runtime class pass is security vulnerabilities in libraries you are using. These could be exploited at runtime of your application. Thus, it is important that you check your runtime class pass, which is usually what you deliver as part of your application, for known vulnerabilities. Also, if you don't change anything on your software dependencies, new vulnerabilities might be discovered and get known. So it might be good to upgrade a library you're using even though your software hasn't changed. To do this automatically and regularly, there's also a community plugin, the OWASP Dependency Check plugin. It uses the OWASP database of known vulnerabilities to automatically check jars on your class passes. Let's have a quick look at how to use this plugin. I have an example setup similar to what I used in the previous videos, where my application consists of two modules, a module module and an app module. I could check all the different class passes I have for vulnerabilities, but if I only deliver a single application, which means I deliver the jar that contains my application code, the jars of all my other modules, and the jars of all the dependencies I'm having, it is sufficient to check the runtime class pass of my application so I don't do the same checks on similar jars again and again. So the configuration I will show today is for checking this one class pass, the application runtime class pass, for vulnerabilities. To use the dependency check plugin in our setup, we add a dependency to it in the build Gradle file of our convention plugins, similar as we have done in the previous two videos where we used other community plugins. And because I'm only concerned about the runtime class pass of my application, I apply the plugin in my application convention plugin. The plugin provides the dependency check extension to configure details. Here we can configure which class passes of my project the plugin should check. By default, it would attempt to check all configurations that are available, which are potentially class passes. In our case, as I said, we just want to check the runtime class pass, which I think is a good default for a single application project. With this, the plugin is already sufficiently configured for our setup. There are more details you can potentially configure in other project setups. Have a look at the documentation of the plugin for this. In our project, we now have a dependency check analysis task. Let's call it. What the task does is first downloading the vulnerability database if it hasn't done this before. So when you run this for the first time, it might take a few minutes. The downloaded information is cached by the plugin, and if you call the task again, it will only attempt to update the information, not downloading everything again. After the download is completed, the plugin checks the jars on your class pass for known vulnerabilities. So in our case, the plugin informs us about a known vulnerability in Commons I/O 2.6. Once you have this information, you have to figure out where this jar comes from. In our case, it's quite simple. We only have two modules and a few dependency declarations. So if we check our build Gradle files, we can see that we defined a dependency to exactly this jar here in our module. We can change the version of Commons I/O here, for example, to 2.8. And when we run the check again, we see that no more vulnerabilities are found. In other cases, it might be more difficult to find out why you actually use a certain version of a dependency. For more discussion on this, check out my other videos on dependency management in Gradle, in particular the video on centralizing dependency versions. If you followed one of the suggestions there, you would probably have some central place where all your versions are defined, and so you can go there and change a version of a problematic dependency there. But also in these cases, the version might not be there if it only comes in through a transitive dependency of external components. So as an example, consider that we would have a dependency to Commons File Upload instead of Commons I/O. Commons I/O is actually a transitive dependency of Commons File Upload, and the latest version of Commons File Upload is 1.4, which we use here. If we run the dependency check analysis now, we get informed that we have Commons.io 2.2 on our class path, which also contains the vulnerability already. In this case, we got this jar on our class path because Commons file upload depended on it, but it depended on an older version and Commons file upload itself was never upgraded. To influence versions of transitive dependencies, we can use dependency constraints. If you manage your dependency in a central place, like your convention plugins or platform project, you might already use dependency constraints for all versions anyway. In this case, as we don't have this in this example, although you should in a larger project, we can add dependency constraints directly to our application build file. So we add a dependency constraint to a higher version of Commons.io. By this we tell Gradle that a higher version should be used if this dependency is encountered transitively. If we run the dependency check analysis now again, we can see that there are no more vulnerabilities found on our application's runtime class path. Vulnerabilities in well-known and widely used third-party libraries can be a big issue. So having an automated check that informs you as soon as a vulnerability is discovered that concerns your application is very valuable. In large multi-module projects, it's often confusing which version of which dependencies are used where. The dependency check plugin I showed in this video is operating on a class path, so on the jars that will actually be delivered as part of the application in the end. So no matter which conflict resolution or version selection Gradle did before it actually downloaded a jar, the plugin checks what you actually get in the end. And usually it is sufficient to do the check for the runtime class paths of the applications or services you deliver. If you combine the analysis plugin I showed in this video with the ones I showed in the previous two videos, you have a quite solid setup for a Java project where Gradle informs you or automatically resolves potential issues on your compile class paths or runtime class paths. You can check out my Gradle project setup how-to on GitHub, where I combined all these plugins in a setup that is closer to what a realistic project would look like. I linked the how-to repository in the description of this video. Now that we have looked at the most important aspects of how the class path concept of Java is used by Gradle to support modular Java projects, we can look at Java's module paths in the next videos. Please subscribe to the channel to get informed when they are available. See you next time.